measurement of temperature from this, you know, this is the twir with the two-color pyrometer. We did the measurement, and that is about the temperature that we measure at the twir, this is the raceway temperature. You see, if you have a pulsating flow, the temperature is higher. If you have a steady flow, we could do this because we had a compressor, we could do it. Steady flow, the temperature is lower. That's not what I'm getting at. Of course, we have completely characterized the, you know, temperature profile of the furnace. If you look at a day blast, if you have a 20 degree blast and the relative humidity keeps on going up, the temperature drops of the raceway temperature in front of the twir, burning with moisture brings down the temperature. So if you have, I will need a couple of minutes more. So if you have higher humidity, your furnace is colder. And when is the lowest humidity in air during a 24-hour cycle? Early in the morning when the dew has fallen. That is why they finish their furnace at around 6 o'clock or so. Okay, so this is why their myth. Their myth is not some, they don't use the lime at all. Let me skip this. They don't use the bellows. They have the bellows. Some of them, we found a young man who had made his own hand blower using mitti and all that. Very, very creative fellow. He had it, but in the bhatti they would use this alone. You saw what happens to the temperature. But that is not all it. We did some experiments using pulsating flow against, this is lime calcination we did. And you see, if you do pulsation, the percent dissociation goes so much higher. So that led to an M.Tech work of ours. And recently, one of our students completed a PhD work. And you will see, due to pulsation, the rates of reactions are all high. Okay, so there is a lot to learn whenever you go and study a technology from a different epistemological philosophy. They have developed their technology with a different epistemology. So we need to approach them with a great amount of modesty, then there is a huge amount to learn. And that is it. Yeah, most of these, almost all the photographs have been taken by my student Shirish Wagulde, who spent a lot of time with them. And some of them, of course, have been taken by me. And they were all my students. Thank you. I exceeded by 1 minute now.
Professor Anathan, Dr. Pradeep, Professor Lele, and the fellow participants, I have great pleasure to be associated with BVS in this afternoon. And I would like to express some of my opinion about the ancient casting processes. So I would like to show you, the metal casting in ancient India. Is the first, or even present also, casting is the first important step. For any product manufacturing, you make a molten metal, pour it into a cavity, and allow it to solidify. That is called casting. And then, but cast product is not used in a critical service condition because of large degree of micro segregation, coarse dendritic structure. So you subject them to secondary processing, roll it, forge it, extrude it. But casting is a step process only. So, but ancient India also, they used to know this casting process. And process was popular in ancient India, medieval India, and all the details are not recorded properly. And in fact, whatever information you get One is the excavation, second is the ancient literature, like Vedic period and others. Now excavations are not complete. Whatever limited information available, now you looked into the Nalanda. Only one third has come brought out on the ground. Two thirds are still there in the ground. Even in Jaipur, you know, all the kind of informations that only little bit excavation was carried out, then it was a stop. So we don't have much information. And ancient literature, now ancient literature are in Sanskrit. Sanskrit also has changed significantly. And those who know Sanskrit, they may not understand science and technology. Those who understand science and technology, they do not know Sanskrit. So it requires to be a very concerted effort in studying the ancient heritage. And this information required to be studied. But even historians, they classify. Professor Ranganathan in the morning, he just showed in a graphical way, these are all the different periods, Stone Age, then Copper Age, Bronze Age, Iron Age. It's all well known, well documented. So period may be shifting from here to here a little bit, but these are all unanimously agreed upon. And from the brass age, there was a lot of monuments and products were made that could easily be melted, that it easily be poured, and make it into various shapes. So that period was very enriched in making casting. Then Iron Age came, and slowly people have started knowing how to construct furnace for melting iron and so on. Now these are all the periods we have listed. So there is no need, these are already known. We start from 2500 BC, and that include dancing girl. Now all the speakers have shown dancing girls of Mohenjo-daro and Harappa. And then arrows, hooks, rails, bowls, these came in 2000 BC. 300 large scale means jewelries is all documented in the book of Chanakya. But these are all one line information is given, and one need to decipher it. I had a neighbor, Dr. Dongre, who is unfortunately no more. He used to decipher the Sanskrit sloka, Sanskrit word, and he used to be very angry that today Sanskrit guys, they do not know properly. Like we say, veg means velocity. He used to show me that it is written that vega gatikaya karanam. So what is the karan for gati is veg, means veg is force. So like that, each word he used to decipher, and he has many contribution in the ancient, not only in metallurgy, but so many other things. We will not go into detail. So the people knew how to make casting. And the casting was very, very well known from a very earlier stage. And they used to be, but the success of casting, those period and even today, how prepare the mold, that is makes the success of the casting. So they used to have open mold and closed mold. Later on it came. Even in open mold, they used to make from sand. Sand were readily available. They make the cavity, pour the molten metal, top surface of the melt is exposed to the atmosphere. So heat extraction occurs by radiation, by convection, and the surface quality is not very good. Even today also, sand casting is not used for a very good surface finish. So that they knew, and it daggers and all such implants they used to make it. But their quest did not stop, and then they continued, and even 2500 BC, Harappan and Mohenjo-daro's excavations has brought out the casting god. Important means everybody shows casting god. What is the interesting to me that the development of art in those period, not only as a casting in those period, because an artist or sculpturist, how do they present the emotions of a god, and how do they represent the emotions in a casting? Writer, they express the emotions of the character of their drama, and it is very well compared the Shakespeare drama with that of Kalidas. And what are the art of Shakespeare and art of Kalidas? So how their characters they used to express if they are in anger, if they are in happiness. So these are all the art. And so the art is very important. So we can know that. So these are very, very well developed in ancient India. And then this is yet another investment casting, and those castings of dancing girl, now they used to make by investment casting, which give rise to very good surface finish. Such a complicated shape casting. This is of 11th century Chola regime. And now the same investment casting, now moving from 2500 BC to 1100 BC, and now even in the modern time, this is a turbine blade, gas turbine blade, that used to be made by investment casting because the surface finish is so good. They used to carry out directional solidification and beautifully control the microstructure here. So investment casting has continued maybe from very ancient time to medieval period to the present time. And so what does we learn from that? That whatever the ancient things we knew, that is a nucleus, and this nucleus can grow to a large technology. And that is important. We have to look from that angle. So nucleus may be very small, but its importance to produce a product at the end is important. So we should look into ancient metallurgy from that angle. So it's a very simple process that you have a wax mold, and wax mold now you assemble into a pattern. This pattern is dipped into a slurry of refractory material, and then this solidifies, and periodically you deep and solidify 4-5 times to make a thickness of the cell, and ultimately you melt it off, and after melting, so the wax pattern has taken away, and then you pour the molten metal, and then it solidifies. So you have a very fine surface and get a complex shape of the casting. Nataraj and all they used to make. So they had a very perfect ideas. Now then important thing in a casting that you have to make a hollow casting. How do you do that? So you have to introduce a core in the casting, and molten metal will be poured around the core. And once the casting solidifies, then you take out the core. This technology, this is of course, in 7th century, made in Egypt. Egypt people, they used to make the cat. This is very famous, like we have a dancing girl. Everybody used that. So this is a core casting technology. And they knew, so means there were only three important civilizations. The Mohenjo-daro, Harappa, coming from Sindhu Ghatis, and Egypt and Mesopotamia, these were the civilization, and then they used to exchange among itself. So this is the all important development took place at a earlier stage. Now, the Wootz state is a talk about, I have borrowed it from the book of Professor Ragnathan, and they have shown the microstructure taken from C.S.S. Smith and Verhoeven, and all such things shows a beautiful dendritic structure. So we got tempted that these dendrites, you just subject them to forging, and after forging you get a different kinds of microstructure. So here it is shown that how does the liquid metal solidifies. There is a typical dendritic structure. Solutes are ejected in the interdendritic region, and then the solid liquid interface advances. So you see the kind of patterns of the liquid, solid, and semi-solid state. And then, depending upon what is the solid content, what is the iron content in the liquid, and then all the dendrites, in a group of dendrites, they meet at the common boundary. So it forms grain. So you may have an aqueous grain structure. Each grain, there are a number of dendrites you would have seen in the image. So that is the important. Now, what is the composition? What is the temperature gradient you apply? That may give rise to different kinds of microstructure. Now, the manganese, for example, if the dendrite grows, then carbon also gets segregated in the interdendritic region. And then you just roll it. So there is if there is a manganese, then manganese decreases the activity of carbon. So wherever there is a manganese in the interdendritic region, carbon content will be more. So there are all the carbides, non-carbide, carbide, non-carbide is called banded structure. Today also, normally people get banded structure, it's well known. And so if you roll it, so what is important that if you forge such kind of product, then the carbides are fragmented to a smaller carbides, and then you get a necklace-like structure. So the Damascus sword, because wood steel was sent to Syria, and Syria they prepared the Damascus sword, and then they have a necklace-like structure. Without aid of a microscope, you can see that how the carbides are organized in a beautiful pattern. And that can be possible only because if you just forge such a structure, so composition control, these things were very well known. And then we try to analyze some microstructure of coins, because those king of their time, they used to prepare the coins in their put image on that. And this we examine that this may be silver base, silver 20 copper alloy. So it's a beautiful dendritic structure, interdendritic region is a post-eutectic. This is the copper base alloy, copper 20 silver. And then sometimes some coins used to show also the twinning structure. It means the cast structure they used to press or used to force to shape it, because just casting would not have been adequate. So some twinning and other also, but it needs to be more micrograph to verify the twinning structure. Coming to iron pillar now is the talked about the processing methodology and other. I'm not at all convinced, because this iron pillar is a tapered structure, and just by direct reduction and pressing and forging, can you align the slope of the iron pillar? So we prepared iron pillar, replica of iron pillar, when Madam Prime Minister Indira Gandhi was Prime Minister. And then there was a Hanover World Technical Fair. So then the message came to SAIL. I was there in SAIL R&D. And the message was that you present some kind of heritage of the country in Hanover. So whole SAIL organization got, and because as an R&D person, I tried to coordinate it. People did not agree to make iron pillar out of a kind of composition we have similar to mild steel, because it will corrode in 3 months in Hanover. And also, so we decided to make it out of a stainless steel. And two ingots were made in the alloy steel plant Durgapur. These are all welded, transferred 11 ton of ingots to Durgapur steel plant. And they have a very huge machining, lathe machine. And then they tapered machine. They made a beautiful tapering. And then they prepared it. And then top part of the iron pillar has not been talked about. There are fine in carving. How to prepare that? So we conducted the Kulti, West Foundry, in a SAIL plant. And then they made pattern, then they cast it. Now the challenge is to weld cast iron with a stainless steel. So these are all riveted and welded. It was flown to Hanover. Now the same iron pillar is there in Pragati Maidan. Somebody can go and see that. So all these interesting things. And Ramchandra and others, they have measured. There is another iron pillar in NML campus also, that made of that type of 50 or 55. So these are all the composition. Now at the end, before I conclude, I would like to say that first time the scientific aspects of solidification came out 65 years before only. And these are all the credit goes to Bruce Chalmers and his group. They're all the classic people in solidification. Tiller, Jackson, Rutter, and first time they did a quantitative analysis. If a metal freezes, how does the solute get redistributed between solid and liquid? And the solute gets accumulated at the interface, solid-liquid interface, then solute is get transported by diffusion in the liquid, and then they bring out the concept of constitution supercooling. Melt air, the interface consciously supercooled. So if the interface advances in the undercooled liquid, it gets stabilized, so that how it forms shale, then diet. But this is not the end. This is a still accepted process. But now there may be a lot of complex phenomena in the liquid. There may be convection. There may be other phenomena. Much more understanding has been developed. So with this, I can summarize it that the metal and materials have contributed to the growth of human civilization for a long period. And without metals and materials, there is no branch of engineering. Neither mechanical, electrical, computer, any branch of engineering is visualized will not survive at all. So metal and materials are important. And then there is a great heritage of casting metallurgy in the ancient India, and progressive growth of metal casting exhibits the arts and culture also of the contemporary periods. And also at the end, the Indian metallurgical heritage has given way for the growth of modern technology of the present time. So thank you with these remarks.
Thank you, sir. I request Deshpande sir. We'll have a question and answer session just for 5 minutes because we are running out of time.
So, first of all, let us give a big hand to all the five. I think we have got a good feel of what our ancestors were doing. Even though science was not developed, but they were great engineers. And I feel that we have to bring that memory back. So, let us have some questions to all the distinguished speakers. Fortunately, we have starting with Professor Ranganathan, Professor Jaini, great metallurgist here, and fortunately they have also worked with ancient metallurgy, so they can throw some light. Yeah, please.
I just want to make some comment about your the statement which you made, like without knowing science.